You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good afternoon. Today we're going to be talking about human rights. So we're going to first start off with defining what human rights is. And one of the questions that I'd like to ask you all is, why do you think human rights are denied? You can call in at 1-800-339-1193 or you can email askdhtv@gmail.com on answering why do you think human rights are denied. So first of all, what is human rights? Okay, human rights is defined as the political rights and civil liberties recognized as inalienable for all people. Now, human rights stems from a liberalist perspective, more from liberalism. And why do you think human rights are denied? And I ask, you can call or you can email. But one of the reasons why human rights are denied is because some people want control over other people. This could be based on the government of that country, or it could be based on somebody just trying to have power over someone else on an individual level, which we're going to be discussing very shortly. So those are some of the reasons why human rights are denied. Someone wants control over someone else, they want power over them, and they don't want them to fulfill their full human rights. Luckily, here in our country, we do have human rights. We had borrowed them from a philosophical foundation when we started our country here in the U.S. So a lot of the stuff that when we built our constitution, we borrowed it from British thinkers. So one of them in particular is John Locke. John Locke believed in the idea of natural rights, the life, liberty, and the pursuit of property for individuals to have a balance between citizens and their government. And also, too, if citizens are upset with how their government is run, they have the right to dissolve that government if it does not uphold their protection of liberties. So I want to talk about our rights in the beginning, and then we're going to take a look at rights from other parts of the world. We're going to be looking at different parts of different countries on how they go about denying human rights to their people. So let's first talk about the U.S. Bill of Rights. Now, we talked about the U.S. Bill of Rights the second week of our class session, but I just want to go over them again briefly before we start looking at rights of other countries so you can examine why our rights tend to be honored compared to other countries. So our first right is freedom of expression. Amendment number one, freedom of speech, religion, media, petition to government for grievances. Personal security, which would be amendment number two, the right to bear arms. You know, some countries don't have that right, but we here as citizens in this country, we do. Amendment number three, quartering of soldiers. Amendment number four, against unreasonable searches and seizures. Amendment number five, double jeopardy. Amendment number six, right to have a speedy trial. This is not always the case in other countries. They could be sitting in jail for a very long time and don't even see a judge. And that happens. The right to have a jury. Amendment number eight, the right against excessive bailing. And amendment number nine and 10, reserved rights. So just a brief cap of our rights, our human rights, what we have here in our country. And now let's talk about China. Now China, human rights in China, they actually have a lot of censorship going on in the internet. So the citizens living in China, they cannot, as you know, China is a communist country. The government has a lot of control of their people over there. And if someone were to type democracy into an internet search engine in China, it comes up blocked. Anything that comes up with Tibet or Taiwan China, equality, democracy China, any of those types of keywords come up blocked. And they also have a very unfair judicial system. As I mentioned, here in our states, we have the right to a speedy trial, the right to a jury, but that's not the case in China. They could be in jail for a very long time, and a lot of times, some of these people end up getting killed, end up going having a death penalty there, and having no say. So a lot of innocent people do die in that country. And not just, you know, democracy and whatnot too, but they also have issues there with religion. So if you, you know, they say that they allow people to praise who they believe in, but In reality, just I want a personal comment, a friend of mine is a Christian missionary in China, and whenever we email her, she asks us not to mention anything about the religion because they are being watched. So that's how real it is over there. It's a lot different. So I want to take a look at the internet and how Chinese people, their rights are a lot different compared to the U.S. people. So let's take a look at this video about the internet in China.
While Western democracies share in an internet relatively free of political censorship and intrusion, China has proven that authoritarian governments can embrace the economic benefits of the internet while maintaining their grip on power. But doing so has been neither easy nor cheap. In the first 5 years of commercial internet access in China, about 20 million Chinese got online, or less than 2% of the population. They were mostly young, urban, and tech-savvy. An astounding 40% of the Chinese population has got online since. China now has nearly as many people online, 564 million, as America and the European Union combined. People are getting connected all throughout the country, with a vast majority of people in China's biggest and wealthiest cities now online. Penetration is growing most quickly in China's rural areas, with help from a leap in internet use via mobile phones. With less than 40% of the population online in many Chinese provinces, a far lower percentage than in the developed world, there is a lot of room for growth. China's e-commerce market is growing even faster than people are getting online. With almost $200 billion in transactions in 2012, it's on its way to surpassing America's. China has showed that it can monetize online gaming as well as any market in the world. The Chinese online gaming market has well more than doubled in size since 2008 to about $9 billion. More than 500 million accounts, not all of them real, are registered with China's leading microblog, Sina Weibo. Nearly 50 million are considered daily active users, and they drive the daily discussion of news in China, transforming the public sphere. China's Great Firewall, under construction since the late 1990s, blocks a number of foreign websites, including Facebook, Twitter, and YouTube. And China's internet ecosystem can be inhospitable for foreign internet companies, foreseeing uncomfortable compromises, including censorship. Google tried a Chinese-based search service before pulling the plug in early 2010. So instead of Google, which isn't blocked but is slowed down by the Great Firewall, people use Baidu. Instead of logging onto Twitter or Facebook, people post their thoughts on Sina Weibo or Renren. Instead of YouTube, people watch Youku Tudou. All of these platforms employ monitors who delete posts on sensitive subjects and answer to Chinese propaganda officials. That doesn't mean people can't complain. In January, people vented on microblogs about an awful bout of air pollution that affected many Chinese cities. The government responded, tightening fuel standards. This kind of adaptive authoritarianism is as tricky to manage as the internet itself, but it is the strategy for keeping the Communist Party in power in the modern age.
Okay, very interesting. So do you see how they provide censorship and monitor what's being said on the internet? Because you do this because you want control over the citizens, but also too, if they're complaining or criticizing or however you want to say it in regards to what is going on in the economy or social level or cultural level, it does raise awareness on these social media platforms. So it's very interesting. So yes, Facebook, Twitter, YouTube are actually not available in China, which makes it very interesting. So as let's just say, for example, you as an American citizen or resident are traveling to China and want to get onto these social media platforms that you may use regularly here in the States, is not available there. I was also looking at Google has actual Google a base in Hong Kong, so that's available, but I did not see it so readily available for China. So why don't we take a look at the second video clip about Facebook in China.
The list of foreign websites that are blocked in China is long and growing, leaving many foreigners living here longing for easy ways to keep in touch with family and friends at home. BN reporter Zach Reff now takes a look at why social networking sites like Facebook are being censored and what expats in China are doing to cope.
Last summer, Facebook suddenly became inaccessible in China, joining a growing number of sites such as Twitter and YouTube that are unavailable here. For those familiar with the workings of the internet in China, the reason for the downage was immediately clear. The site had become yet another casualty of the Great Firewall of China. Facebook had been censored. According to figures released by Inside Facebook, a company that analyzes Facebook trends, the social networking site had 1 million active users in China just before it was blocked last year. And then, within a few months of the site being blocked, that number dropped to just 14,000 users, a decline of more than 70%. The Chinese government doesn't discuss which sites it is actively blocking, nor does it offer reasons for individual sites being censored. After a brief period of relaxed control in 2008 that corresponded with the Olympic Games, the government clamped down during the past year and a half, blocking dozens of sites frequented by foreigners. Analysts note that much of this increased censorship corresponded with sensitive political dates last year, including the 20th anniversary of Tiananmen Square and the 60th anniversary of the founding of modern China. Both Facebook and Twitter, meanwhile, were blocked as rioting broke out in Xinjiang, a province in the far west of China, last summer. Some analysts also believe that the blocking of foreign sites is done to give domestic competitors an edge, a criticism that has intensified since Google pulled out of mainland China in March this year. According to Jeremy Goldkorn, the founder and head writer of the prominent China-centric blog Donwei.org, which was itself blocked last summer, the censorship of foreign websites became endemic last year.
Half of the international internet as used by ordinary users doesn't work. You know, Facebook's down, Twitter's down, YouTube's down, and has been, you know, both, all those three for most of this year.
To many expats in China, including Jeremy, the reasons for this increasing censorship are elusive.
You know, we don't really believe there's any reason for us to be blocked, but what can we do?
Whatever the cause, the censorship of these sites impacts the lives of many foreigners around China as they struggle for ways to share their experiences with friends and family abroad.
I feel slightly cut off from friends and family at home. I'm from England, and I use Facebook is one of my main ways of communication. It's kind of replaced my email at the moment and MSN. So I used to be a quite frequent email and MSN user, and now because of Facebook, that's my main source of communication.
In 2008, Facebook added simplified Chinese to a list of available languages on the site in an apparent attempt to snare some of the massive Chinese internet market. The tactics seemed to work, and for a while, the site was adding thousands of users each month in China. This, of course, all came to an abrupt end when the site was unexpectedly blocked last year. Still, while the censorship of foreign networking sites might be upsetting to expats here, Chinese netizens have no shortage of social media sites from which to choose.
I use Xiaonai, QQ, and MSN.
Of course, Chinese sites aren't immune to censorship either. Many Chinese internet users practice self-censorship to avoid sites they frequent being shut down. Yet even this tactic didn't spare some sites from being blocked last summer. Users trying to access blocked websites in China are either given error messages indicating that the connection has timed out or that the search was reset. If you type in Facebook.com, you'll get this. If you type Twitter.com, you'll get this. And if you type YouTube.com, you'll get, you guessed it, the exact same screen. Of course, tech-savvy internet users around China are able to find innumerable ways to access censored sites, such as by using anonymous proxy servers and virtual private networks. These users play a continuous game of cat and mouse with the Chinese government. Shortly after users find a way to break through the blockade, the Chinese government usually catches on and implements new censoring techniques.
I went home for a few months during the summer, and when I came back, a lot of the proxy servers that I'd been using previously had been blocked. And I was also using quite a common one for a couple of weeks, but that's been blocked now as well.
And, as unbelievable as it might sound, for some internet users, being censored isn't always a bad thing.
Being blocked has given us more credibility in certain quarters because people are saying, well, you must be doing something right if you got blocked.
Others have found that the lack of computer-based social networking in China has given them more time to pursue other activities.
I'm somewhat glad because it's freed up a lot of my time, because it does lead people to waste a lot of time, and I spend less time on the computer and more time outdoors.
Whatever the outcome of such censorship, the Great Firewall of China doesn't look like it will crumble anytime soon. And for foreigners living in China, this means that they'll probably continue to be face-blocked for a long time. Zach.
Okay, interesting. Okay, so as you saw, the Facebook, Twitter, YouTube are blocked in China. So, you know, certain websites that we're so used to using here in the States are not readily available for someone living in China. So, you know, what are your thoughts about that? We're talking about human rights today, and we define human rights as political and civil liberties recognized for all people. But as I mentioned, and I'm asking you all, students and those who are watching, is why do you think human rights are denied? You can call in at 1-800-339-1193, or you can email askdhtv@gmail.com. We just saw an example of China and the way the internet is being used over there. So I have some comments. This is from Makayla. Historically, few societies understood the concept of human rights. Each time a group achieved human rights, it was through a long, hard struggle with those in power. Okay, very good. That's a great comment. Thank you, Makayla. I think I have another comment as well. This is from Allie. I'm so glad I live in a place where the people have the power and not a place like China where the government is the ultimate power. Okay, good. Very good. Definitely. So you can see how our rights are different from those that are living in China. Very good. Okay, so moving on. We just took a look at China. I briefly want to talk about human rights, especially as it pertains to women that wear the burqa. But just to start off with, human rights is not always guaranteed, unfortunately. Especially in Arab countries, about 55% of the women can neither read nor write. And also, too, the rights between men and women are different. The man is more superior than the woman and is the head of the household, especially in countries such as Egypt, Lebanon, and Saudi Arabia. Also, too, I wanted to mention that sometimes, or a lot of times, these women are discriminated against because of their cultural differences. Now, there are some countries where the woman is actually the head of the household. I was told one of my friends that's from the Philippines, actually the woman is the head of the household in the Philippines. But when it comes to the Middle East, that's very different. Now, as you can see here in this picture behind me, as you can see, the women are basically covered, from head to toe. And that's part of the religion, and that's the way they feel that they have to be in front of in public. But there was some controversy in France where they wanted to place a ban, and they actually did end up achieving placing a ban on the burqa. So they put a ban on the burqa in all schools, public transportation, anyone who was working for the government. Women who would wear the full veil, from head to toe, would be denied services such as work visas or even French citizenship. Now, in France, there's a very large Muslim population there, and they were wearing the full burqa from head to toe, but the government got involved and said that the women are no longer to wear that, and they did pass a law in that just recently, some years ago. Prior to that, Netherlands also banned the full burqa, as well as Belgium was actually one of the first countries to actually put a ban on the burqa. And in some cases, women, if they are caught wearing the burqa out in the streets, they would be given a fine. And the fine varies from 150 to 190 from what I saw. But, what are your thoughts on that? Do you think the ban on the burqa in France is justified? What do you think? Or is that inferring their religious rights? So what do you think about that? So why don't we take a look at this video on the burqa?
Pin has just become a criminal. From today, a new French law bans covering your face in public. It's designed to make Muslim women integrate in society. But the softly spoken single mom says it's had the opposite effect.
My friends have simply stopped going out at all.
The new rulings made some scared to speak out, but many vow not to change the way they dress. The move undermines what the French Republic stands for, says this businessman. He pledges to pay the €150 fine for anyone who continues to wear a veil and is taking the dispute further.
We are suing France in the European Court of Human Rights. It's about freedom of expression.
Abderrahman Dahman was fired as Nicolas Sarkozy's integration advisor last month after criticizing the president's approach. He now calls on French Muslims to wear a star similar to the one forced on Jews by the Nazis.
These governments should learn how to negotiate.
Opinion polls show record low approval ratings for the French government, with accusations it's deliberately stirring interracial tension.
Friday prayers in Paris. Muslims are forced to worship on the street. The government blocks the building of basic public prayer rooms. More discrimination, say worshippers, against the Muslim population.
France has seen riots in recent years against government policies. There are signs of more brewing.
It is a distinct possibility, especially when the domestic decisions and events and foreign decisions and events come together.
Those foreign events have also outraged partners in Europe. Jenning blames France's illegal deportation of Roma and sending North African refugees back to Italy in the face of international anger. That splits the Franco-German axis that drives the EU.
This axis, as it has been called sometimes, is not functioning.
Analysts fear France can no longer lecture Muslim regimes when it picks on its own ethnic minorities.
Why should we stop prosecuting Christians if you are prosecuting Muslims? Saying you have absolutely no credibility and reliability to tell us what we should do.
But cracks are forming within the French government over its hardline policies. Several high-profile politicians in the ruling UMP party last week quit. More are expected to do the same in the coming days.
Okay, so we're taking a look at this about the ban on burqa. Now we're talking about human rights and, you know, what are your thoughts on the ban on the burqa in France and also in other European countries? Do you think that's justified? Or do you think that is a violation of their human rights as it pertains to their religious rights? Because in the Muslim culture, they are supposed to wear and honor their full veil from head to toe. So what are your thoughts on that? And also, too, I wanted to insert that also in other Middle Eastern countries, such as Saudi Arabia, women are actually not allowed to drive. Now, some women actually go ahead and drive a car, but they actually they don't recommend, and they actually have a ban on having these women drive vehicles. Now, I know there have been some stances that they are going to allow women to have a driver's license, allow women to drive, but according to their culture, if they were to leave and go out, they have to have a male guardian accompany them. They can't just go and visit, you know, somebody without having a male guardian with them. So very protective. And so just a different culture. It's a very different culture over there. So we'll probably see them. I know they're going to they don't have the rights to vote, actually, either. And they're supposed to be given the right to vote next year in 2015. So as you can see, it's a lot different compared from the States, as you can see in the Middle East. And it's a lot different. So anyhow, going on to human rights, you know, why do you think human rights are denied? If you can call in at 1-800-339-1193, or you can email askdhtv@gmail.com. Just a reminder that we are recording live here in Carson, California at Cal State Dominguez Hills. So human rights. So usually when there's a lot of democracy, when a country is very high in democracy, that means a lot of human development tends to increase. So there's a lot more political freedom. There's a lot more democracy, a lot more civil liberties and civil rights. And also, too, the more we do see trends, political scientists, we do see trends that when countries have more money or a higher GDP, that means that the country is more likely to be free, usually. More likely to be free, more likely to be democratic. Autocracies or autocratic countries, those are countries that are not ruled by the will of the people. So they usually make policies that favor themselves and their immediate cohorts, but not for everyone, which is very unfortunate. Now, I have a comment here. This is from Ali. Human rights are denied because people get greedy. When somebody gets a little power, they always want more. And people with less power are willing to give up rights in order to remain safe. Interesting. Very good, Ali. Very good. Thank you. Okay, so human rights. So the UN, the United Nations, they have what is called the Universal Declaration of Human Rights. This was created in 1948, and there's five basic categories. The first category is the rights of the person, life, liberty, and security, as which we mentioned when we started the program. Also, right number two is rights associated with the rule of law. So equal recognition before law. Number three, political rights, freedom of expression. Number four, economic and social rights, free choice of employment. So people should have the right to choose where they want to work at. Number five, rights of communities, self-determination and protection of minority communities. So those are some human rights, basic categories of the UN Declaration of Human Rights. Now, moving forward, talking human rights here, there's also different organizations that could take part in helping craft human rights. We talked about, some of the people who are affiliated with what goes on when it comes to international law or international policy. It could be anyone on an actor level. It could be people that shape the trends that just transform international politics. It could be an individual, it could be me, it could be you, it could be a country, it could be an organization. A lot of times these people are citizens, bureaucratic governments, or multinational corporations, and also even terrorist groups can also be a part of that because they try to change policy in their own way. Now, state actors are, it's basically a country has a permanent population and is the most important actor when it comes to this. And the head of the state is usually the president, or it could be royalty, or it could be a prime minister, depending on the country. IGOs, we're just going to recap this here. IGOs, intergovernmental organizations, are organizations whose members are national government entities. So, for instance, the United Nations, the members are representing countries. The European Union, same thing, the members are representing countries. The Organization of Petroleum Exporting Countries, OPEC, same thing, they're also representing countries. The World Treaty Organization, WTO, and the North Atlantic Treaty Organization, also known as NATO. Other people who are involved in this as well is MNCs, multinational corporations, like the major ones, like Microsoft, Sony, Toyota, IBM. Any company that's not just in the U.S. but also in another country are considered to be MNCs. Now, non-governmental actors, also known as NGOs, are members, are individuals and groups. So, for example, Oxfam is very popular, especially in London and in the United Kingdom. Human Rights Watch, there's a Human Rights Watch here in L.A. I believe there's also one in Northern California. There's one in New York, and they have office in London and also in Paris and all over the world. There's also your local Lions Club, your local Red Cross. Amnesty International does also very great work, and they do have chapters all over the world and all over the state, and ACLU. So Amnesty International is actually an international organization. It's a global movement of people fighting injustice and promoting human rights. They actually protect people wherever justice, freedom, truth, and dignity are denied. And they are considered to be the world's largest grassroots human rights organization. They investigate and expose abuses, educate and mobilize the public, and help transform societies to create a safer, more just world. Actually, Amnesty International some years back actually even won the Nobel Peace Prize, so that's pretty big. Okay, so Amnesty International, they do back up and they do support the 1948 United Nations Universal Declaration of Human Rights, as I just mentioned a little while ago. And so if you are interested and would like to get involved in an organization, in an NGO or a nonprofit organization, I would recommend them. Some other issues that come across in international women's rights is domestic violence, female genital mutilation, which we'll talk about in just a moment. Forced marriage and forced pregnancy, sexual slavery and rape, especially as it pertains during times of war and also in prison. 80% of refugees are women and children. So when things get bad in their country, they have to leave and go somewhere else where they can have a safe haven. Now, FGM, female genital mutilation, is also referred to female circumcision, genital cutting, and usually in African countries is considered to be a coming of age ritual that signifies a girl's entry into womanhood. Now, not that long ago, I believe it was in 1996, someone had left one of the countries in Africa and came over here to not have that procedure done. And luckily there was a law that was created here in the States that bans that. But they've actually have created laws, international laws, to make sure that women are not getting that procedure, but it could still be happening. Anyhow, the reason why they do this is because in the culture, they feel that when they do a FGM, it actually prevents promiscuity among the young girl, And but what usually really happens is they actually have you know, problems. They have medical problems. They have you know, infection, a UTI, a urinary tract infection. They can have problems with complications in childbirth, as well as infertility. And this can also include hemorrhaging. So and also too, their culture too. They feel that sometimes they feel that you know, the men may not want to be with these women because they haven't been circumcised yet, because that's the way they think and that's their culture. But anyhow, yeah, like I did mention, in 1996, the U.S. Congress outlawed female genital mutilation in this country. And after, soon after that, the United Nations announced a global campaign in 1997 to make sure that this practice does not keep on going. And a growing number of refugee women and human rights organizations in Africa have, around the world, have called for this prohibition. So some partial countries that pertain to FGM are Benin, Burkina Faso, Cameroon, Central African Republic, Chad, Egypt, Ethiopia, Ivory Coast. So this is just an example, sample of some countries that have practiced FGM. The World Health Organization, also known as the WHO, has estimated over that more than 130 million women have gone through this procedure. So why don't we take a look at the UN, African Women Condemn Female Genital Mutilation. Let's take a look at this.
Malaycha used to be a well-known female circumciser in the Cheha district in Ethiopia. She works in this small workshop over 8 hours every day. And even though making pots is tiresome and less profitable, she still prefers it to her previous occupation as a circumciser.
My life was terrible then. The moment I closed my eyes, I dreamed of girls screaming. I won't do it again for whatever money I am offered.
Malaycha's choice to abandon female genital cutting is a brave statement in a country where it is largely believed that a girl that is not circumcised will misbehave or be disobedient to her husband. In response to the magnitude of the problem, the Regional Women's Affairs Bureau, in partnership with UNICEF, started implementing abandonment of FGM and cutting.
We selected 6 facilitators from each sub-district. They usually are influential in their villages. They might be religious leaders, elders, health extension workers, administrators, or leaders of women's associations or youth associations.
I'm so grateful viewing oneness at this conference.
The issue of FGM was also discussed at the Pan-African Parliament's Women's Conference. The conference aimed to create a platform where women could express themselves, come up with strategies to tackle the problem, and dispel the myth behind the traditional practice.
I have circumcised girls for 15 years, because according to our culture, if a girl is not circumcised, she will misbehave and be disobedient towards her husband. But now I have participated in community dialogue. I understand that I lost 7 of my 9 children because I was circumcised.
Through community dialogue, the practice of FGM can slowly be abandoned. But there is still a long way to go. In Ethiopia and across Africa, campaigns on FGM are essential to bring the fulfillment of the rights of girls and women into a more and immediate reality. This is Natasha Ikoli reporting for UNICEF Television. Unite for Children.
Okay, so thoughts on FGM. I'd be interested in learning what your comments are. You can call in or you can email. So we're talking human rights, and one of the questions I asked was, why are human rights denied? Why do you think human rights are denied? And just a little while ago, we saw a video clip on the burqa ban in France, and do you think that ban was justified, yes or no? So just a few questions as it pertains to this topic. If you could call or you can email your questions or your comments. This is from Paige. I do think it infringes on women's rights. My question is, why would any group want to self-identify and relate that identification back towards anything Holocaust-related? You know, that's a very good question, because I was kind of puzzled myself when in the video they were showing that they wanted them to wear green stars. I was like, well, why do they have to wear that? That's identifying them and kind of outcasting them and separating from other people. So I'm not exactly sure why they would do that or why they were trying to do that, but that's just not right. So thank you for that. This is from Makayla. The burqa ban is denying the right of religion and therefore human rights. We should all have the right to wear and believe what we wish. Okay, good. Very good. So in pertaining to the burqa ban in women, how they ask them not to wear the full veil from head to toe. This is from Katie. I think all the issues we are discussing about human rights stems from control. It all goes back to that. The ban on the burqa is the same as all other civil or political rights. Someone wants control. Okay, very good. You know, somebody wants control over someone else, you know, depending on how they dress or what they believe in. You know, and the question here is, are they denying them of their human rights as we are watching this? This is from Paige. Human rights most invariably are denied when those in rule feel threatened. Okay, very good. Now, Paige, with that comment, why would you feel that those who put, you know, deny them the human rights, why do you think they feel threatened? And especially as this pertains to France, why do you think the French government felt threatened because they, you know, have individuals wearing the full burqa ban? Okay, this is from Makayla. The Muslim faith is controlled by men, so maybe Muslim women are not choosing to choose the burqa. I think it's important to determine that these women really do want to wear it. Okay, very good. And from what I saw, a lot of women do want to wear it, from what I saw, but I think that also depends up to them and to their culture as well. So very good. I have some very good comments. Feel free to send them in as we talk about this subject. Now, a little while ago, we talked about the burqa ban, as well as I mentioned briefly about the women in Saudi Arabia. And as I mentioned, just wanted to recap on that, is that the women in Saudi Arabia can't be alone with another man if he is not family. And if that woman were to travel and go meet a friend, they have to go travel with a male companion. They also have the lack of right to a fair trial in Saudi Arabia, which is a lot different. And Saudi Arabia is the only country in the world, that bans women, both Saudi and foreign, from driving. So the prohibition forces women, families, to actually hire live-in drivers. And those who can't afford the $300 to $400 a month for a driver must rely on male relatives to drive them around. And so very different, you know, so they can't, you know, just leave and go as they choose, because they have to have a male companion. But also, too, they can't transport themselves. They have to rely on someone else to drive for them. And that is going to be costly if it's not, you know, a family member who can, you know, take them and drive them around. So just very different. Also, too, as I mentioned, women will be given the right to vote and participate in elected office starting next year, starting in 2015, which is a lot different than it is here in the States. So that's women in Saudi Arabia. Also, too, just to mention, and no adultery in countries such as Egypt, Egyptian men can actually be excused for killing their wife if they found them in acts of adultery, which is very, very harsh. But women who killed their husbands for adultery would be given the death penalty. So you see the difference here. You know, an Egyptian man can be, you know, excused for killing their wife if they found them in acts of adultery, but women kill their husbands for adultery would be given the death penalty. And so, as you can see, the preface here is given more to the man than to the woman here. Why don't we stop right here for a break? We'll take a 5-minute break and we'll come back and we'll discuss more about human rights.
You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
My name is Grant Wagner, and I'm a teacher here at Menachie High School, and I've had the good fortune to be involved with the Young Scholar Program through CSU Dominguez Hills for over 10 years. We have encouraged our kids to take on this opportunity, this challenge, for various reasons. One, it allows our students, for a very nominal fee, $3.50 for a college class, to experience what college is going to be like.
What I like best about the program is how it fits to your schedule. Like, you can watch the lectures whenever is convenient for you, and it's really easy to talk to the professors.
And these students, whether they pass or fail, are learning some valuable lessons about what it's like to be a college student.
The thing I like best about the courses I take through the Young Scholar Program is the difficulty of the courses. A lot of people think that they're easy to take, but they're actually pretty difficult, and they challenge you and they really make you think, and that's how college is going to be. So it really prepares you for college.
This program is really an incentive for students that have a 3.0 grade point average and are ready to face the rigors of the college environment.
I encourage students to enroll in the Young Scholar Program at California State University Dominguez Hills because of the advantages they have when they leave high school. They have college credit at an incredible value.
What Dominguez Hills is to me is actually just a great learning environment for me because of the Young Scholars Program. It's really helped me just know a lot more about marine biology and astronomy, and currently just like logic and just the individual in society. It's just all great classes, and it's really nice to like use something that you don't really learn in high school, get outside information from Dominguez Hills, and just apply that to the outside world.
This series of classes allows our high school students, it empowers them to solve their own problems. And the Young Scholar Program allows the kids to do that.
Hi, my name is Mar Briones, and I'm a junior here at California State University, Dominguez Hills. I'm a business major, and the reason why I chose this campus was because of its location and good business program.
Watching DHTV, the broadcast program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Okay, welcome back. So, talking about human rights, so why do you think human rights are denied? And we saw a few examples of the burqa ban in France, and some of these students did share your comments, but I would appreciate those of you who are watching is, why do you think human rights are denied? You can call in at 1-800-339-1193, or you can email askdhtv@gmail.com. Now, I have a comment here. This is from Katie. It seems difficult to compare human rights in the United States with other countries. So many of them are deeply engrossed in cultural issues. To them, some of what we see as wrong is not wrong to them. Okay, good, very good. So it's a very different perspective. It is very different. So this is from Rodrigo. Are there still types of government that run today that are a monarchy or has a system of government that is ruled by one person? Yes, Saudi Arabia, they do have a king. Also, I believe, in the United Arab Emirates, they also do have royalty like a monarch. So there are, and also the Bahrain in the Middle East. So yes, there are quite a few countries that still run as a monarchy. Yeah, so thank you, Rodrigo. Okay, so going back to human rights, we've been looking at different issues. So why don't we talk about honor killings and what honor killings are. Now, honor killings are women can face death by shooting, burning, stoning, or by axes by being in an illicit relationship. So for instance, women who marry men of their choice or being seen with other men or divorcing their husbands can be subject to honor killings. They can also be murdered if they are raped. So basically, honor killings is if they don't marry or be with someone that the family recommends because they are defiling their honor for their family, they could be subject to killing. So, for instance, if they marry men of their choice or being seen with other men, or they divorce their husbands if they decide they don't want to be married to that person anymore, they could be subject to an honor killing. They can also be murdered if they are raped. So if they happen to be raped in public, they can also be murdered. So anything that brings shame to the family defiles the honorship to that. So it also is publicly demonstrated. And honor killings is very, it happens a lot in countries such as Iraq and Pakistan. So honor killings is there's tribal codes in villages that creates this oppression on women, and so women are considered property of their males and their family, irrespective of ethnicity, class, or religious group. The owner of the property has the right to decide its fate. A lot of times, marriages are arranged by the parents. A lot of times, and so what happens is police, they take the family side and honor killings and highly persecutes the individuals who committed the acts. And also too, there's a lack of women's shelter. So women are going through this problem. They can't just go to a friend or go to a family member and ask for help. They actually are on their own when it comes to this. So it's very unfortunate. So actually in countries such as Pakistan has failed to train its police and judges to be gender neutral, which results in a violation of international law because their culture is different, where the man is considered to be superior. So why don't we take a look at honor killing in Pakistan? Let's take a look at this video.
Well, Haq is going back to the home he has avoided for almost a year. To the house where he lived with his wife and two children. The walk up the stairs is agonizingly hard because inside and stacked on a single shelf is all that is left of his family. Ehtisham finds his children's blankets, his wife's handbag, her pots and pans covered in dust. Her name was Nargis. They had fallen in love after he had given her a ride in his taxi. And they were blissfully happy until she was found dead in a field, stabbed, shot, beaten, and strangled. Their son's anorak is wrapped in the shawl his wife left behind. Their children were killed first, and there's a simple dignity now in doing up their buttons. The buttons of a four-year-old boy and a baby girl who were thrown from the roof of a building while their mother was forced to watch.
When I came to the door, और अलीशा जो था ना वो यूं मतलब चल तो नहीं सकती थी लेकिन इसी तरह घसीट घसीट के मेरे पैरों के पकड़ के कड़ी होती थी फिर मैं उसको गोद में उठा लेता।
The last time he saw his children was when he took them to the shops for a packet of crisps. Then his wife received a phone call. It was urgent. Her mother was sick and dying. She had to rush to the bedside. It was a lie. Nargis's family disapproved of her marriage to a mere driver, and they were luring her into a trap. When Nargis didn't come home, her husband went back to driving a minibus to distract himself from the worry. His passengers saw photographs of his murdered family in the newspapers as he was driving. He didn't have a clue that the family they were telling him about was his.
एक दूसरे को बता रहे थे कि ये तस्वीरें देखो कितने अच्छे प्यारे पता नहीं ये कौन बदकिस्मत होंगे तो मैंने यूं उनके पीछे देखा मैंने कहा पता नहीं कौन होगा मैंने देखा है लेकिन मैंने उनको नहीं पहचाना क्योंकि उनके शक्लें इतने खराब हुए थे
Nargis was murdered near her hometown of Mardan. It looked like a so-called honor killing and her family were the prime suspects. But instead of seeking justice, Pakistani police arrested Ihtisham and his two brothers, who say they were tortured for 4 months.
मेरे भाइयों जो बड़े को पकड़े थे ना पुलिस वालों ने उनको कहा भी था कि तुम लोग सिर्फ इतना कहो तुमने नहीं किया हमें पता है कि कत्ल ये तुम लोगों ने नहीं किया ऐसे चो ने कहा सिर्फ हमें इतना बता दो तुम बयान अपने भाई के खिलाफ एहतिशाम के खिलाफ बयान दे दो कि ये कत्ल उसने किए उनको पीछे कमर पे मारा गया चमड़े से फिर यहाँ तलवों से मारा गया उनके साथ बहुत ज़्यादा बुरा किया जो मैंने कभी भी भाइयों के जब मेरे भाइयों का तो कभी लड़ाई भी नहीं हुई लेकिन जब अगर किसी ने कोई गाली भी दी है ना तो मुझे बहुत बुरा लगा बहुत ज़्यादा बुरा
ओके सो ऑनर किलिंग सो वी आर टॉकिंग अबाउट हाउ वुमेन कैन फेस डेथ बाय शूटिंग burning, stoning, or by being axed by being in an illicit relationship. In this video that we're watching, the wife was killed and also their children were killed, very unfortunately. But why this happened is because the family, the woman's family, did not approve of her marrying her husband. You know, so if women are not following the family's, you know, culture or, you know, tradition of having an arranged marriage, or if they're doing something that's defiling the family name, they are subject to honor killing. So why don't we take a look at the second part of that video about honor killings in Pakistan.
Last year, this court released Ihtisham and his brothers after a judge agreed they had been framed. His dead wife's own mother is now on trial along with her brother, uncle and aunt. But her husband fears the family have paid bribes so that the case will never be heard. It's almost a year since the murders now, yet there have been no funerals. Ihtisham is still looking for the bodies of his family. At the local cemetery, he can find no graves with their names on. But the gravedigger does remember a hasty burial and how he dug a hole for a mutilated woman and two small children, right here. Ihtisham pulls back the grass by hand. He has found his adored wife Nargis, his baby girl Alicia, and his little boy Cheyenne. He uses a simple brick to mark the spot where he says his wife's family covered up their terrible crime. Ihtisham wants a moment alone, but it's too noisy here to think. This is no place to reflect on the murder of his wife or of his children hurled from a rooftop in front of her. Can you remember how you felt at that moment when you were clearing the grass of this unmarked grave?
उसको अभी तक मैंने ठीक नहीं कराया क्योंकि मुझे यकीन ही नहीं हो रहा कि ये वो है या नहीं है लेकिन वो कह रहा था कि ये है ये वो लड़की है जिसको ज़बह किया था इस तरह इसको मारा गया है ये वो बच्ची है जिसके जिस्म पे चुरियों कुल्हाड़ियों के निशान थे ये वो लड़का है जिसके ऊपर निशान थे लेकिन मैंने जब उनको कफन में नहीं देखा तो मैं मुझे अभी यकीन ही नहीं हो रहा कि वो मेरे बच्चों के मेरी वाइफ के कब्रें
Etisham told me his wife had been killed because she had disgraced her rich family by marrying a poor man like him. He carries photocopies of her letters, over 70 of them, full of the desperation of forbidden love.
I love you very, 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 very much. I miss you. I miss you very much, all the night and day. Bye.
Back in his old home, this was the moment he dreaded most, sorting through his children's abandoned toys. In a neighborhood now too painful to stay long.
वो दुकान जिस पे मेरे बच्चे आते जाते थे. उधर से चलना फिरना बहुत मुश्किल होता है. उस गलियों में मेरे बच्चे खेलते थे बहुत ज़्यादा.
And he's talking to me, he says, because it's his only hope of getting his family's killers jailed.
मुझे अपना फिकर नहीं है कि मुझे मार देंगे, बस सिर्फ मेरे बच्चों को कातिलों को सजा मिल जाए.
Okay, it's very sad about what happened to this gentleman and with his wife and his two young children, but that's honor killings. And I've also seen an example too of a young girl, a Pakistani girl, who moved to London, to England, with her family, and was pertaining to the, I guess, the British culture and not pertaining to the Pakistani culture. So it was dressing more, you know, like a young British girl or a young American girl, which was to much dismay of the parents, and they actually ended up taking her out. In other words, she ended up being killed. And the parents were actually, you know, trying to lie about it, but eventually they came out to the public that they were the ones responsible for their killing their own daughter because she was defiling the family name. So it's very, you know, very different. You know, some people have, you know, different cultures and different customs. But that's just an example of honor killing of what has happened there. Now, we're talking why are human rights denied? Why do you think are they denied? And we saw an example about the ban on the burqa, and this is a comment from Paige. I think the French government feels threatened as part of the overall post 9/11 sentiment towards Muslims and terrorists in general. While the specific acts of terror may not have been committed by women, I think there's more to this comment here. We could take a look a bit more, or we can come back to it. If you have any questions or comments, you can call in at 1-800-339-1193, or you can email askdhtv@gmail.com. Okay, going back to Paige's comment, while the specific acts of terror may not have been committed by women, this would appear to be a bit of guilty by association as opposed to specifically a human rights issue against women. Okay. All right. So thank you. Thank you so much for that comment, Paige. Thank you. Anyone else? You can call in or you can email. Now, I also wanted to talk briefly about Afghanistan and how Afghanistan has young, very, very young women as brides in Afghanistan. And the women in Afghanistan have a very low literacy rate, so their education levels are not high as they would be here in the U.S. They're very low. The girls and the women do not get educated. There have been more stances for, you know, programs to help Afghanistan women to get, to get educated in Afghanistan. I know Hillary Clinton and some other organizations have been, you know, providing more of a stance to help that country to provide more support for the girls. And I've noticed that education rates, literacy rates have gone up, but they still, a lot of young girls still have not gotten their proper education. So what happens is that these young girls get subjected to be young women brides, and that happens. So why don't we take a look at this video about brides in Afghanistan. Young brides in Afghanistan. Let's take a look at this.
Aida married at 9 to a 60-year-old man. 8 years on, she's on the run from him.
He doesn't care if I'm dead or alive.
Saida is just one girl in the most shocking set of statistics in Afghanistan. 60% of women are still married as children, often at 9 or 10. Under Afghan law, girls can't marry under 16, but the law's ignored by families and the government.
There was an old man in the village who had already killed two wives and had a very bad reputation. No one would even let him take a dog for a walk.
Saida's father died when she was little, and her brothers claimed her as their property. They sold her to the old man as his wife.
If he saw a shoe or a stick, anything, he would beat me with it. I spent 7 years with him, as if I was sitting on a hot stove all the time. I had 4 miscarriages because of the beating and the stress.
Then her husband took Saida on the road, all over Afghanistan, to places where they weren't known, to make money from her. He sold her, forced her into having sex with other men.
He would say I was his daughter. He actually sold me to 3 or 4 people. You understand what I mean? He took money from these people. I would cry and say, for God's sake, what's happening to me?
It was in Mazar-e-Sharif, a government-controlled city, that I found Saida. She'd confided in a woman at a shrine. The police were alerted and Saida was taken to a woman's shelter. Now her stepfather and staff at the shelter are helping her to get a divorce. But Saida's husband won't agree to let her go. He's unlikely to ever be prosecuted for what he did to a child.
I am very scared. He is in touch with my stepdad through the phone. When I talk to him, he says he is praying to God for an opportunity to drink my blood. He says he wouldn't even care if he dies after that.
Saida's childhood has been destroyed. She's 17 and can't read or write. But she knows that only by educating girls and boys will Afghanistan's women be brought out of the dark ages.
All the problems we face are to do with a lack of schooling. People who are educated will not make their daughters and sisters suffer.
Okay, very unfortunate what Saida had went through. She went through domestic violence. She was being human trafficked. Her husband had her as a prostitute. Very, very unfortunate. But stuff like this happens. And it happens, it could also happen here. You never know, but it also happens in other parts of the world. Now, what I'd like to do is talk about human trafficking, because this leads a very segue to that. Now, human trafficking, what that is that individuals are being trafficked against their will. They're being trafficked against their will, and a lot of times these individuals, they end up being sex slaves or being subject to a life of prostitution. So this is something that's against their will. There are individuals who are out there that do that willingly, but here I'm talking about they're doing this against their will. That's the key word here, individuals that are trafficked against their will. Now, another thing that women or even men also, they're also subject to be domestic workers. So they could be like maids and within a household. And that's also another part of human trafficking. Also, to adult and child laborers is another aspect of human trafficking, as well as child soldiers. Child laborers is very common, especially when it goes to the chocolate industry, and we'll probably see something more on that as we go into this topic more next week. And child soldiers as well, we see situations, especially within Sierra Leone. So also to another part of human trafficking is forced marriage, as what you saw in this video clip just now about the young Afghan girl who was being forced into a marriage that she did not consent to. And also her being a young girl makes it even worse. Another section of human trafficking is organ trafficking, which is another aspect of human trafficking. So not just the person itself, but now body parts, especially kidneys, are very common when it comes to organ trafficking. and all this stuff does happen. Now, human trafficking, going back to domestic workers, as I mentioned, it just doesn't happen, you know, in other parts of the world. It can happen here, and it could probably even happen in your own city. So just to keep note, I saw not that long ago in the city of Irvine, California, there was a young Egyptian girl who was, you know, living within the household and was there, I saw this in the news, and was there as the domestic servant. So she would have to cook, clean, do all of that stuff, and she was not going to school. Now what happens is that one day this young girl, she was 16 at the time, was outside getting the trash, and the neighbor had saw her and said, hey, you know what, why aren't you in school? Because it was the time that she should be in school, and the girl didn't respond. The neighbor was very proactive, and he saw that, and they called the cops, and they come to find out that the girl was actually being trafficked. Supposedly, the Egyptian family that she was staying with, that her parents had a debt with that Egyptian family, so in order to pay off the debt, they had given given them the young girl, the daughter, to go stay with them and to be the domestic servant, which is totally illegal and totally wrong, and that's human trafficking. She was there against her will. And so fortunately, the people who had her there, the individuals living in Irvine, they ended up going to court and going to jail. And now, from what I heard, is she did get adopted by a couple who was in law enforcement and is going to college. And I would assume now she's probably done with college and probably already in her career. But this was not that long, it was some years ago. So like I said, human trafficking is not just, you know, one part of the world. It could be anywhere. It could be here. It could probably be even in your own city. You may not even know it. So the thing is, you have to, if you see individuals who may not, you know, speak the language or are always accompanied by someone, or you see a visible, you know, abusive marks, just to be proactive and take the right precaution by, you know, making a phone call. So going into human trafficking, what I'd like to do is a look at human trafficking here in the States when it comes to modern day slavery. So let's look at human trafficking, modern day slavery in America when it comes to young West African girls living in Newark, New Jersey, who are being subjected to do hard labor and not getting paid for what they're doing, and also being there against their will. So why don't we take a look at this video, Human Trafficking, Modern Day Slavery in America. Let's take a look at that.
These girls were victims of something hard to believe, something you might never expect, something that happened in plain sight. You are looking at girls who were held as slaves in America, not for a week or a month, but for years.
Can you tell us about what it was like having someone else control all of your movements, everything you did?
It was like being, you know, being trapped, you know, being in a cage. It's horrible. Mm-hmm. You know, like sometimes it's not enough food for us to eat, no freedom at all.
Nicole and Zena and another 20 girls like them were brought to the U.S. from their homes in the West African nations of Ghana and Togo nearly a decade ago. Barely teens, promised an American education. They were instead enslaved in Newark, New Jersey.
What did the traffickers take from you?
They took my childhood from me, my teenhood. They took it from me. They took my trust from me, and they took everything. They took everything away from me.
The girls were forced to work in hair braiding salons, serving customers all day, right out in the open. Their captors took all the money the girls earned, every penny.
How many days a week were you working?
7 days a week.
How many hours a day?
Sometimes 14 hours.
This went on for 5 to 6 years. Traffickers held the girls in several houses in Newark and East Orange. The traffickers no longer live there.
This is the neighborhood where these girls were being held, and just look at it. Manicured lawns, nice houses. It looks like any neighborhood in America, and it definitely doesn't look like a place where you'd expect to find slavery.
Who would commit such a crime? These are the traffickers. Akawavi Afolabi, the wife, was the ringleader. Lasisi, the husband, and Derek, the son, were accomplices, according to court documents and law enforcement. Why did they do it? Money. Pure and simple. They made about $4 million off the girls. Paul Fishman is the U.S. attorney for New Jersey. His office prosecuted the case, resulting in convictions.
I think it's hard for some people to believe that in the year 2010 we have people who will actually put people in slavery. It's the most fundamental and intolerable violation of human rights.
A Newark court recently sentenced Akawavi Afolabi to 27 years in prison. The father got 24 years and the son 4.5 years.
But after all the promises she promised me, and then when I got here, all my life was messed up. And I always tell her, if I knew this is how my life was gonna be, I'll never come. I'll never let her take me.
The fact that my clients could be in these hair salons for so many years braiding hair as young as 9, 10, 11, is extremely frustrating, but it's not shocking. Human trafficking is extremely profitable. It's so profitable that we're seeing some drug traffickers get out of drug trafficking and into human trafficking.
Zena took me on a walk where the girls used to walk every morning to work, from the house to the hair salon down the street. Slave girls walking in plain sight of an entire community.
I always thought of running, but I ain't know nobody, and I didn't know where to go.
Finally, after 5 years, a tip came to Immigration and Customs Enforcement, or ICE.
These girls were shielded from the outside world, virtually hidden in plain sight.
After months of surveillance, ICE agents raided the houses. Inside, they found the girls, mattresses on the floor, and filthy conditions. The traffickers had hidden bags of cash and the girls' passports. Something else the agents found? A notebook the girls used to track the tips they received at the hair salon. Ironically, on the cover of that notebook, a picture of the Statue of Liberty. After so much pain, the girls, now young women, were free.
It was a good day because, you know, it helped my life. I was so happy that I was out from the jail. All I did was cry. It was, it was overwhelming. I told myself she finally, you know, she finally got what she deserved. She did really, really wrong. She treated us bad, and she was heartless. When I think about it, she was heartless. And I'm happy that she's caught.
Amber Lyon, CNN, Newark, New Jersey.
Very unfortunate what happened to these young girls. They were, you know, promised a better life, a better opportunity. They leave West Africa, they come to the States and end up being subject to work labor where they're not getting paid for and against their will. Very unfortunate. Why don't we take a look at California, especially as it pertains to Prop 35. We talked about propositions in California politics a few weeks ago, where Proposition 35 was passed. We did pass that law, but this was in 2012 where Proposition 35 was on the ballot. But why don't we learn more about Proposition 35? Let's take a look at this video.
Proposition 35, human trafficking, penalties, initiative statute. Plain language, increase human trafficking penalties, expand sex offender laws, and beef up human trafficking training for law enforcement officers. There are two types of human trafficking. Sex trafficking, which is kidnapping people and forcing them to have sex, and labor trafficking, which is kidnapping people and forcing them to do work. Obviously, it is illegal to do both of these things, so don't even think about it. Human trafficking is currently punishable by state law for up to 5 years in prison, but if the victim is under 18, then it's 8 years in prison. If the victim suffered great bodily injury, an extra 6 years can be tacked on. As of this year, only 18 people are in prison for human trafficking crimes. If Prop 35 passes, it would expand the definition of human trafficking to include the creation and distribution of obscene materials depicting minors, and the duplication or selling of obscene materials, even if the offender had no contact with the minor depicted. It would create more severe criminal penalties for human trafficking. 12 years per offense for labor trafficking, 20 years per offense for sex trafficking adults, life for sex trafficking of minors that involved force or fraud, and an extra 5 or 10 years for repeat offenders. Fines of up to $1.5 million can also be imposed. Money collected from the fines will support services for victims of trafficking and law enforcement. 70% of the fines would go to public agencies and nonprofit organizations that provide direct services to victims, and the remaining 30% would go to law enforcement and prosecution agencies in the jurisdiction where the charges were filed and used for human trafficking prevention, witness protection, and rescue operations. Prop 35 includes some legal changes as well. Under Prop 35, victims could not be charged with a sex crime if it was a result of trafficking. Some defenses would also now be unavailable to defendants in trafficking trials, like ignorance of the victim's age. During trafficking trials, the victim's credibility cannot be impugned because of acts committed during trafficking. It also requires convicted traffickers to register as sex offenders. It requires sex offenders to provide the names of their internet providers and all internet accounts to local police or sheriff's departments, including email addresses, usernames, screen names, and any other personal identifiers for internet communications and activity. Any changes in these categories would require notification to law enforcement within 24 hours. Prop 35 requires at least 2 hours of human trafficking training for all police officers, highway patrolmen, and sheriffs that work in the field. Fiscal impact. Financially, it's all rough math, but it is anticipated that this law will cost a few million dollars for prosecution and incarceration expenses, and a few more million in training programs for police officers. But it is expected to bring in a few million dollars in human trafficking fines. Long story short, Proposition 35 increases the penalties for sex trafficking, expands the definition of sex trafficking, creates new laws for convicted sex offenders, and requires police officers to take human trafficking training. For the yes side on Proposition 35, they say, human trafficking is one of the fastest growing criminal enterprises in the world, and it's happening right here on California's streets and online where young girls are bought and sold. A recent study gave California an F on its laws dealing with child sex trafficking. That's why we need Proposition 35. Proposition 35 will increase prison terms for human traffickers to hold these criminals accountable. It will require convicted human traffickers to register as sex offenders to prevent future crimes. It requires all registered sex offenders to disclose their internet accounts to stop the exploitation of children online. And it increases fines on convicted human traffickers and uses these funds to pay for victim services so survivors can repair their lives. Sex traffickers prey on the most vulnerable in our society. The average age when a girl is first trafficked is 12 to 14. The traffickers grow rich and throw their victims away. Prop 35 will hold these criminals accountable and protect children from sexual exploitation. And the opponents of Prop 35 say you should vote no because this measure is allegedly aimed at human trafficking but actually threatens many innocent people. If Proposition 35 passes, anyone receiving financial support from normal consensual prostitution amongst adults, including a sex worker's children, parent, spouse, domestic partner, roommate, landlord, or other, could be prosecuted as a human trafficker, and if convicted, forced to register as a sex offender for life. Maxine Dugan, one of the Prop 35 opponents, remarks, "My son, who served our country in the U.S. military and now attends college, could be labeled a human trafficker and have to register as a sex offender if I support him with money that I earn providing erotic services." Rather than working with sex worker communities to stop real human traffickers, the far-left anti-sex feminist and the far-right religious conservatives who back Prop 35 hope voters who hear trafficking will be deceived into supporting their futile crusade against the world's oldest profession by further criminalizing people connected with consensual adult prostitution. It will allow the government to criminalize adults who were arrested for prostitution under the guise of rescuing children. Criminalizing prostitutes is the condition that allows exploitation. They say Prop 35 would create a new unfunded liability for our state, just when California's government is in fiscal crisis and numerous cities have already filed bankruptcy. A wealthy executive supplied over 90% of Prop 35's campaign donations, but his money won't be there to fund enforcement. The idea that traffickers will foot the bill for new criminal justice expenses is wishful thinking. Forfeiture hasn't paid for the war on drugs, and it will never adequately fund a war on prostitution either. If this passes, California will be writing another blank check to the proponents of Prop 35. If passed, the state will likely be required to defend the statute in courts, as it will likely face legal challenges due to several questionable and possibly unconstitutional provisions.
Okay, they provided a lot of good overview about Prop 35, about the people who supported it and people who were against it. And just I wanted to note that Proposition 35 did pass, and that was on the ballot in 2012 when there was a bunch of other propositions on the ballot in that same year. So that did pass. And I'm very thankful that Prop 35 did pass, which is actually one of the legislations that I was working on in regards to training for police officers on the U visas, which we're actually going to talk more about as we go in more into depth into human trafficking next week. But in regards to human trafficking, as I mentioned, you know, human trafficking just doesn't happen overseas. It also happens here in our own country and possibly in our own cities with us not even knowing. So just, you know, to keep in mind is how can we go about seeing the signs of a human trafficking person, you know, how can we go about seeing the signs? So we can watch this clip on signs of human trafficking in Hawaii. Let's take a look at this.
Hawaii is a hub for human trafficking because of our location as the crossroads of the Pacific. Young women are brought in from all over the world to work in the sex trade. Some come here as mail order brides or domestic servants. Teenage girls are even targeted by pimps in local shopping malls. Men from countries with struggling economies are also recruited to work on farms and fishing boats for little pay. After paying thousands of dollars to recruiters, abandoned victims can be found washing dishes in restaurants or doing construction and landscaping jobs for cash under the table. They can barely survive on what they make. Many are separated from their families for years, unable to return home. In short, human trafficking is a form of modern-day slavery. So what can we do about it? The first thing is to recognize the signs. Does the person appear to be under someone else's control? Do they lack control over their personal schedule, money, or identification documents? Is there evidence of bruises or physical abuse? Does the person seem fearful or afraid to speak freely? Are they under 18 and hanging around adult places? Here are some questions you can ask. What type of work do you do? Are you being paid? Can you leave your job if you want to? Have you or your family been threatened? What are your working and living conditions like? Do you owe money to someone for arranging a job? Has your identification documents or passport been taken from you? It's not just the streets of Waikiki or Chinatown where sex trafficking occurs. Psychologist Judy Okawa says we should keep our eyes open for men who are preying on young girls at places like shopping malls.
Locally in Hawaii, what I find of grave concern is the fact that these recruiters for trafficking are going to our shopping centers to recruit young girls to go into the sex trade. And what they do is they said there are a lot of tiers of traffickers. And on the first tier is a handsome young man who'll go to the shopping center and find some girls that are hanging out. And he'll befriend a girl and he'll learn everything about her and pretend to be her boyfriend. So he'll ask her, you know, oh, tell me all about you. You're so beautiful. And, you know, let's hang out and flatter her. You know, you're so pretty. You could be a model. Wow. And eventually he'll know everything about her vulnerabilities, you know, how she really needs love and he's going to give it to her, and how her mom is mad at her and how she doesn't like school. And then this young girl will find herself in a position where eventually this man will say, you know, there's this great job I could take you to down in Waikiki. You know, you could make a lot of money. You want to go with me? And she will go with him. And he will then literally hand her over to the next tier of trafficker. And at that point, it's all over for her, because she will be shut in a room and the punishment will begin. And she will be then trained how to be a prostitute with no chance of escape, because then the threats begin. You know, we're gonna kill your mama. We know you live on that street on Kailua Road. And she's lost this boyfriend. He took his recruiting fee at the door for bringing her in. And nobody knows where she is. And essentially what the parents think is she's a runaway. And that's what the police think too. So nobody really looks that hard for her, especially after a long time has elapsed. And this poor child is then really trapped.
Victims of sex trafficking may have urinary tract infections, kidney problems, or untreated STDs. They may have scars and bruises from physical beatings. Kids who are exploited often have severe psychological problems such as post-traumatic stress disorder, depression, and panic attacks. If you see or hear anything that seems suspicious, do not attempt to rescue the person yourself. You could put yourself and the victim in danger. The best thing to do is call the Pacific Gateway Center or national hotline number on the 808HALT.com website. Please just don't walk away and wonder if you could have done more. There are many victims who need our help and they're afraid or unsure what to do. Human trafficking is modern day slavery. We all have a duty to respond.
Okay, so some of the things that I wanted to outline in that video that we just saw is how the young girl was being recruited by, you know, a handsome young man and flattering her and whatnot. That's known to be called the Romeo effect. They pretend to be the girl's boyfriend, and then lo and behold, they put them into a life of human trafficking. Also, too, as I mentioned, you know, human trafficking does not just happen here. Doesn't just happen here in the States. It could happen in our own cities. It could happen, you know, all over the world. So human trafficking is worldwide. Now, I just briefly wanted to mention an incident of a very family friend, actually, who actually was trafficked. We came across her through religious services, and that's how we got to know her. But she was brought from Peru, said she'd have a better job. She came here to the States, and she was working as a maid and was not allowed to leave the home. Fortunately, she made friends with the gardener, and she had a life of freedom after that. But like I said, it does happen. So we're going to continue with the subject of human trafficking next week, and we'll talk more about the subject, and we'll go more into depth about that next week. So thank you very much.